you. A very big welcome to Christ Church Quinton this evening for our carol service, the second one of the evening. It is lovely to have people in real life here in church with us. Welcome to you at home as well. Thank you for joining us online. I can see that we've already got 29 people online, and we know that people are watching on YouTube later as well. So thank you ever so much for joining us online for what's going to be a wonderful evening service celebrating Christmas together. For those of you who don't know me and haven't met me before, my name's Rachel, and I'm the vicar here at Christ Church, and it's my absolute privilege to be leading this congregation here as we grow closer to Jesus week by week. One of the wonders of Christmas for me is that it is so unchanging. For you, it might be the things that you do, the habits that you've got, the traditions that you have as a family, things that will be tested sorely this year. Maybe the plans that you had made all came falling apart last night, and as Boris made his new announcement. We need to make new traditions for this year, and we need to do things slightly differently this year. So we are going to do some things differently. So this service is one of those things. So it might feel slightly different. Because of COVID, we're not able to sing with full gusto. We're not able to have a full church. We normally have, we'd be expecting about 300 people at this service. So we're going to be slightly more reserved in our singing. I would ask you respectfully to keep your masks on all the time that you're inside. That's what we have to do, being inside a building. And if you want to mumble along to some of the hymns, you can do it behind your mask. Please do. Those of you who are online, you can sing with all of your heart. You can just sing out loud because you're just at home. We've chosen deliberately some carols that are slightly different, just so that it's not quite the same, so that our sadness of not being able to sing out loud all of the words are slightly pulled back. But there will be things that you recognise. We ask you to keep in your bubble. So for those of you who have come in family groups, you need to just stay together in those family groups. And when it comes to leaving, we need to be really careful that we don't all stampede together and start doing supermarket sweep, okay? So we're not gonna go in and start jostling with each other to get out. Another one of the things that has changed this year because of COVID is that we've got a very small choir, but we're very happy and delighted to welcome this very dedicated bunch of people here. We're just going to have two choir pieces during our service this evening. We just haven't been able to get together to practice, first and foremost, but also we are limited to this number of people in any kind of performance. Some of the readings that we're going to have this evening are from an Advent book called The Greatest Gift. We are following the traditional pattern that we have of going through God's great big story of love for the world. But some of the readings will be direct from the Bible, and some will be more story, more narrative from this book that I've been reading called The Greatest Gift. So in a moment, we are going to sing our first carol. We're going to turn the lights off. And during that first carol, once in Royal David City, some of our stewards, our volunteers, are going to come forward with a candle and take a light from our Advent wreath here, and we'll begin passing it around. Pass it amongst yourselves, just across your families, and then enjoy holding the candle. As always, I need to say to you, be careful that you don't set your tops on. Anything sparkly goes up a bit easily. Be careful. Hair goes up easily. Just be careful. At least you haven't got neighbours that you can set on fire this year. Just to say that the only thing that should be on fire are candles, okay? So if you see anything else on fire, if you're sitting near a bucket of water, I feel like an air stewardess now, if you see a bucket of water near you and you see something that isn't a candle that's on fire, just throw a bucket of water over it. So there's buckets there, buckets at the back. We just need to all be very vigilant when fire is around, okay? So the service will move through, mostly unannounced. I might say a word to say we're moving on to this next thing or whatever, but hopefully the service will have flow and we can just keep on going. So we're going to switch the lights off, and let's appreciate darkness for a moment. Almost darkness. And I'm going to pray to start us off. My brothers and sisters, in the name of Jesus, I welcome you. We have come together as Christmas draws near to prepare for our celebration of the birth of God's beloved Son. Through the days of Advent, we have followed the light of Christ, and now we travel in spirit with Mary and Joseph to Bethlehem to acclaim with the multitude of the heavenly host the coming of the Prince of Peace. Through scripture, prayer, and song, let us hear again the wonderful story of our redemption, and hearing, let us rejoice with lively faith. Light looked down and saw darkness and said, I will go there. Peace looked down and saw war and said, I will go there. Love looked down and saw division and hatred and said, I will go there. So he, the Lord of Light, the Prince of Peace, the King of Love, came down and crept in beside us.
In the beginning. In the beginning is when the greatest story ever told begins. The story of Christmas begins in the very beginning because Christmas is about Jesus and Jesus's love, which has been looking to hold you close since the very beginning of time. Jesus was before time began, his voice hovering over the depths of the darkness. Jesus was there when the voice of God breathed wonder into the darkness. Let there be light. And just the sound of God's voice made light dance into being, all brightness shattering the dark. Let there be land. And at the music of his voice, mountains roared and raised up through the oceans. And God said, let there be living plants, and let there be lights in the heavens. Let there be living beasts. And at the wonder of his voice, leaves unfurled and stars spun happy, and elephants triumphed in praise. But what about when God dreamed up the very best at last? God did not say, let there be, as he had for everything else. When he dreamed of a face like yours, his voice filled with gentlest love, and he smiled. Let us make human beings. God the Father gathered close with God the Son, Jesus Christ, and God the Holy Spirit. And all the glory of the Trinity gathered close when they imagined the masterpiece of you. And God in three persons scooped a handful of dust together and knelt down. And together they kissed warm life into God's children with the breath of his love.
Thank you. And so can we. The whole world unfolds like an art gallery, filled with the glory of God. But what Adam and Eve didn't know was that there is a thief in the art gallery, an enemy of God. Satan is a snake that slithers in at the corner of everything and entangles around you. And that snake sneaked up to Eve, wrapped his own lie tight around her, and hissed his poison right into her heart. God doesn't really love you. God doesn't really give you good things. Eve fell for it. She ate the fruit from that one tree God had forbidden, only because he loved her, because he didn't want her to die. But Eve ate the fruit and shared it with Adam, and the snake's lie and death began to flow through her veins. Adam and Eve ran and hid and fell away from the closeness of God. They were lost. And God comes with a question, not, why did you do that? Or, what did you do? The first question in the Bible is a love question from God's heart. Where are you? God's love never stops looking for you, trying to find you, and gently draw you back close to him. No matter what the day holds, no matter how the season of your life unfolds, God holds you and enfolds you. And what was the very first question in the New Testament? It was the wise men asking everyone after Jesus' birth, where is he? Really wise men and women never stop looking for God. And because God is love, he never stops looking for you.
So we have heard about how we need a saviour, someone to come and rescue us from sin. So we're now going to spend some time confessing before God some of the things that maybe we do that become a barrier between us and him. Christ, the light of the world, has come to dispel the darkness of our hearts. In his light, let us examine ourselves and confess our sins. When Mary and Joseph arrived in Bethlehem, they found there was no room. We confess that in the midst of all our anxieties, we have not made room in our hearts for others. Father, forgive us. We confess that paralyzed by fear, prejudice, or apathy, we have not made room in our homes for the stranger. Father, forgive us. We confess that, forgetting the welcome we have been shown, we have not made room in our church for those who are different from you, from us. Father, forgive us. We confess that in the busyness of Christmas time, we have not made room in our lives for you. Father, forgive us. Gracious God, forgive us and renew us. Use this time to break open our hearts, open our eyes to your presence, and open our arms wide to welcome you. God is good. God is faithful. God is merciful. And God comes to us in vulnerability again and again to show us how much we are loved. We are forgiven. We are freed. We are beloved, we are blessed. Thanks be to God. Amen.
The prophets speak of hope. In the days before Jesus was born, the prophets spoke of a promised Messiah. In Isaiah 7, it says, "Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son and will call him Emmanuel." Two chapters later we read, "Nevertheless, there will be no more gloom for those who were in distress. The people walking in darkness have seen a great light. On those living in the land of deep darkness, a light has dawned. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government will be upon his shoulders. And he will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Of the greatness of his government and peace there will be no end. He will reign on David's throne and over his kingdom, establishing and upholding it with justice and righteousness from that time on and forever. The zeal of the Lord Almighty will accomplish this." The place where this child ruler will arrive is predicted in Micah 5, with yet more insight into what he will be like. "But you, Bethlehem, though you are small among the clans of Judah, out of you will come for me one who will be ruler over Israel, whose origins are from of old, from ancient times. He will stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God. And they will live securely, for then his greatness will reach to the ends of the earth, and he will be our peace."
Christmas is the story of his life. silently, how silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his heaven. No ear may hear his coming, but in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in.
Thank you. into the night, into the cold, onto the stable floor, the Son of God was born. From heaven's throne to Mary's arms, the God who made the stars became like one of us.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, and though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or a husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
The humble God, in your relationships with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who, being in very nature God, did not consider something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing by taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human and being found in appearance as a man. He humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross.
Everybody, it's lovely to welcome you here, whether you're in the building or online. Let's just pray before I speak. Heavenly Father, thank you that you draw close to us this season. May these words be your words. May you speak to us all this evening. Amen. Luther and Nora Crank are fed up with the chaos of Christmas, the endless shopping lists, the frenzied dashes through the shops, the hassle of decorating trees. Where has all the joy gone? This year, celebrating just seems like too much effort. With their only child off in Peru, they decide that just this once, that they're going to skip the holidays. They spend their Christmas budget on a Caribbean cruise, and they set sail on December 25th. They happily settle in for a restful holiday season free of rooftop snowmen and festive parties. But the Cranks soon learn their holiday from Christmas isn't much of a holiday at all, and that skipping the season has consequences they didn't bargain for. That's the synopsis of a book by John Grisham called Skipping Christmas. And it was made into a film a few years ago called Christmas with the Cranks. It follows the antics of a couple who, for many reasons, have decided the best way to actually celebrate Christmas is to skip it. Maybe if you have a few hours over the next few days and you want some festive merriment and humour, I encourage you to find the film and watch it. But I wonder if for this year, we too may have thought about skipping Christmas. Not because the business or the expense or the commercialization, but because it's been a long and difficult year. Restrictions are still in place. Government briefings move the goalposts once again. Maybe you feel that it's very difficult to celebrate with any joy this year. And it's true. In March, who would have thought that by Christmas we would still be in the midst of a global pandemic? Everything's changed. Everything's so much harder this year. All our expectations have shifted. And we're left, like me, with a sense of confusion and bewilderment and heaviness. It's perfectly understandable that this year we might just want to put the duvets over our heads and resurface in the new year. The twinkling Christmas lights and the cozy TV adverts this year seem very out of place in the pain of a pandemic. So tonight I'm wondering, are you struggling to find joy? Maybe you're asking the question of where God is in this year. Why should Christmas still hold meaning for me? Maybe you're here to find a hope or a new connection to that all too familiar Christmas story. And I hope that you will find it this evening, because there is still so much joy and meaning to that long time told story. The Christmas story. There is hope. There is an enduring hope. And that is that God chose to come and be with us. The reading we've just heard is not one of our traditional carol service readings. It was written by Paul to the church in Philippi. And I think he puts it so beautifully when he says that God chose to come and be with us. In some translations of the Bible, it says, God's great love for us emptied himself of all his power and majesty. And he chose to become human, just like us. Fully human, and yet in that mystery, fully God. The Son of Heaven in the form of Jesus came humbly down from heaven, willingly to take up humanity. I like to imagine it as a moment when heaven kissed earth, that climactic moment of God's love for us. God chose to leave the resplendent glory of heaven to walk in the mess of this earth, and boy, what a mess we are in. In the form of Jesus, he came not to be like a human, but to be a human, to be like you and me. God is God. He could have come as a shining light. He could have come as a voice in the clouds. He could have sent a preacher with a message. He could have chosen to be born in royalty, in a palace with royal status and jewels. In fact, he didn't have to come at all. He could have stayed where he was, watching from a distance, disconnected. But he didn't. He chose to come to us, to pursue us, to be born in humility, in a stable, as a refugee, born to a teenage girl. The Word became flesh. Jesus came and dwelt among us. He came as that tiny, tiny baby. But this evening you might be wondering why, in all his power and might, God chose to do that. And it's because God wants you to know that he gets you, that he understands what life is like. He walked the earth so that he might understand everything that we go through, all our difficulties. Jesus is not out of touch with our reality. He's walked in our shoes so that he can understand how we feel. He knows what it's like to be sad, to be hurt, to be lonely, to be isolated. He knows the sorrow that this life can bring. And it's in this season that God comes to us. That is the reminder that he comes to us. He goes out of his way to call us back to him. Everybody. And he does this because he has a fierce love for you and for me. A love that outweighs everything that's going on in your life, everything that's going on in our community, everything that's going on in our world. The hope that arrived over 2,000 years ago continues today. Because Jesus promises to accompany us on our earthly journey. He doesn't bail out at the first crisis. He doesn't bail out when a pandemic is in full throw. He stays with us. He stays with us when the going is tough, when the questions and answers are hard. He knows. Maybe last night, as you sat and watched that briefing, there was pain and sadness and anger. That's all visible to God. He knows all about it. He chose to enter the coldness, the emptiness of this world. He embraced the mess of the earth. But in doing that, he brings with him a warmth and fulfillment. So if God is willing to enter a cold and sinful world alone, born in a manger, then have hope, knowing that God enters our cold and hopeless situations, our messes. God is not far away. He's very near. And when we draw on him, he can change any situation with his presence. He comes to us not just for these 12 days of Christmas. He means to stay with us. And when we understand that, that's what gives our lives purpose and meaning. God is with us. Have the confidence that he is there. He didn't send Jesus so that we could have festive merriment once a year. He was born to give us hope. A hope that not only through his birth, but his death and resurrection, Jesus promises that we will one day be with him in a world that doesn't have pain or suffering or coronavirus. 2020 has been a hard year. And I can honestly stand here and say that my faith has wavered throughout the year. I have doubted and questioned where God might be. My plans went out the window yesterday for Christmas. There have been difficult decisions that have had to be made. And I've been sad and angry. But God understands that. He allows us to lament with him. He gets it. And he longs for us to talk with him about everything that's happening here. When we do that, that is when he draws in close to us. And in those moments of my faith wavering, I've turned back to the baby in the manger, the light in the darkness, in the radical teaching that God loved us enough to become one of us, to show us Jesus. God stepped down because we couldn't step up. So this is the moment of our hope. This is God with us. This is where our hope lies. Not in our turkeys or our presents or our Christmas crackers, not even at our Christmas table, but in a cold, dark stable. Be assured that God knows the darkness that has surrounded us this year. He understands. Therefore, we can trust and rely on him, because he promises to give us strength to get through whatever might happen this Christmas and in the months ahead. So, skipping Christmas? Not this year. Let's believe in the wildest of promises that God became one of us so that we could become one with him. Let's invite him into our homes to celebrate with us. God doesn't have COVID. He doesn't need to socially distance. Let that hope of Jesus penetrate whatever darkness you might be experiencing, because he can penetrate even the darkest of days and nights. And allow him to whisper to you, "I understand. I get it. Draw close to me, for I long to live the life you live." So this evening, I invite you to turn your face towards God, the God who has chosen to make his home within us, the one who offers us the greatest love, joy, and hope. Whatever this season might look like for you, that is the promise of God. In the midst of the darkness, that is where we find our renewal and our joy. The tiny baby who waits for us to respond to him. So, let's leave this place tonight with a newfound joy in our hearts, knowing that Emmanuel, God, is with us.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we pray your blessing over all of your people and your world. We thank you for the world that you have created. You are the source and the creator of all things. This year, 2020, we have seen the impact of COVID-19, and we pray that your love and hope will shine through this situation. We pray for all of the families as they gather to celebrate the birth of your son, Jesus, that their homes and hearts will be filled with your blessing. We pray for your peace throughout your world and amongst each and every family gathered together this Christmas time. Let everyone be enfolded in your peace and know that you are the controller of all things. Let them lay their worries down as they cast their eyes towards you and the birth of our Saviour. Heavenly Father, we ask for your joy as we come to celebrate in festivities. Let us remember at this time all of those who are less fortunate than us. We ask that your joy be shared out amongst them. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the hope that you give us in your Son, Jesus Christ. We ask that all may share in this hope, particularly those who are feeling desperate at this time. We pray for the lonely, those who have lost loved ones, jobs, and those who are struggling in any way. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your love, a love that is so unreservedly given to all, a love given in the shape of the baby Jesus, your Son and our Saviour. We thank you for this love and pray that it's always with us, whether deserved or not. Lord, over this Christmas period, please help us to remember that you are always with us through the good times, the celebrations, through the hard and the dark times. You are the light of the world, the light that dispels all darkness. Heavenly Father, we ask for ourselves that you would help us to reach out to others in love, to share your peace and joy, and be the light in others' darkness. Lord, finally, help us this Christmas to always keep you near, seek you, and know that you are always with us because we are your beloved children. Amen.
On Christmas Day, the dawn is different. Why? Because the glory is rising. Glory to God in the highest heaven and peace to all on earth. God has left the glory of the galaxies and has come down to save us, to love us, to rescue us, to free us. God is here. God is here. Jesus is born to you, to you. The glad tidings are to you, to you. It's like the sky is filling with a light that is different from the sun or the stars or anything of this world. The flame of it lit up the shepherds on the hills, and they blazed bright too, full of wonder. Those shepherds ran all the way to the manger, where even the fiery star seemed dim next to the brilliance of Jesus, the light of the world. It is true. Jesus came to the world for you. Jesus never stops loving us. He comes and gives us himself. For unto us a child is born. Unto us a son is given. God is with us. Jesus is with us. Jesus stays with us.
Thank you.
Just to remind you that Christingle is happening on Christmas Eve evening at 3 and 5 o'clock. We haven't got any space left at the 3 o'clock, but we have at the 5 o'clock if you would still like to come to that. That is a service specifically designed for children. On Christmas Eve later, at 11 o'clock, we've got a midnight communion service that starts at 11. You'd be very welcome at that. And then on Christmas Day itself, if all your plans have changed, why don't you come to church at 9:30 for a joy-filled, all-age communion service. For those of you who might have been planning to come back to church on the 27th, which is the day after Boxing Day, that service has now been cancelled. Due to unforeseen COVID reasons, but we've had to cancel that service now. So if you know anybody who you think might have been going to that 27th service, please can you let them know. You may have heard something this evening that you want to follow up, something that you want to talk about, something that you want to find out more about. We would love to talk more with you either now or in the new year. Do leave your email address if you want us to get in touch with you and to keep you posted, keep you in touch with the things that we're doing in the new year to help us to all get through this really weird season that we're in. So we're going to have our blessing now, and then we will have Hark the Herald Angels Sing as our last song for us to be leaving to. So into the mess of this world, a fragile child will come, yelling in the night for his mother, needing milk and clean linen. We pin our hopes on you, little baby, our God, pushed out into the world through pain and into poverty. Our God is with us, and hope is reborn. So, may the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, the perseverance of the wise men, the obedience of Joseph and Mary, and the peace of the Christ child be yours this Christmas. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with you and remain with you always. Amen. Do blow your candles out before you move. If you want to sing along behind your masks, out loud if you're online, Hark the Herald, our last song.